have a good time. Put a smile on your face, yeah. KB Cam and Elation Radio. Even brighten your day and help you through the night. Bring you good music. KB Cam and Elation Radio. And here's your host.
Change. Hi, this is Apostle Dawn Westbrook. Join me on Shabach Saturday here at Elation Radio at 3 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, where we Shabach the Lord and declare the word of the Lord over your life for this hour. Shalom.
Hallelujah. Glory to God. He is the same yesterday, today, and forever in the name of Jesus. You know, I love that introduction song. It certainly is appropriate for this hour in a world that changes from moment to moment, in a world where new challenges are faced every day. There's something different, something new in the headlines. But our Father does not change. Hallelujah. He said he is the same yesterday, today, and forever. He said he is the Lord God and he does not change. Hallelujah. He said that every good gift and every perfect gift from above, coming down from the Father of lights, with whom there is no variation, he does not change, people of God. He's not a man that he should lie, or the son of man that he should change his mind concerning you, concerning me, concerning the covenant that he has spoken. Will he not fulfill it in the name of Jesus? He said, as the grass withers, as the flower fades, amen. Hallelujah. He is the same sovereign God, the same loving God, the same delivering God, the same healing God, our God, and his word will stand forever in the name of Jesus, because he is faithful even when we are faithless. He cannot deny himself. I praise the Lord for today, this day being the day that he has made. I praise the Lord that we can come here on Shabach Saturday, because we were created to worship him, to Shabach him, to honor him, to extol his name and his character and his nature, and to exemplify him. And everywhere that we are, he should be present in the name of Jesus. The word says in Revelation 4:11, you are worthy, O Lord our God, to receive this glory, to receive this honor and this power and this praise and this Shabbat that we lift up to him. And I want to say thank you to each and every one of you for tuning in on this very special Shabbat Saturday. With me today is the creator, the coordinator, the originator of Harvest Nights. It is a worship, prayer, and intercession at Harvest Mission Outreach Center in Front Royal, Virginia, amen. And it is none other than Evangelist Melissa Ross, glory to God, joining us here on Shabach Saturday. Woman of God, are you with us? Evangelist Melissa Ross, glory to God, we can't hear you, but let's do an audio check.
Can
amen,
you hear
and we'll
me?
Come back to you. I can hear
Hello.
You now. You may want to increase your volume, but praise the Lord. Thank you for connecting with us. Thank you so much for connecting with us. I know that you're very busy.
Hallelujah.
Amen. But thank you for taking time out of your schedule to be with us. We have been given the power and the authority to speak and say something. We have been given the power and authority, right, woman of God, to declare and decree a thing, and so it shall be established. And so here on this Shabach Saturday, that is what we do to encourage the listeners, amen, our audience, and just to lift up the name of Jesus as we Shabach him, hallelujah, our creator. We can rejoice and certainly be glad in this day. For just this moment, this opportunity that we have here on Elations Radio with Dr. Kimmy Kim in the name of Jesus. But I want to say thank you again, Evangelist Melissa, for being with us. And let me also say amen. I'm just so excited to go and move this puppy along the way. Amen. I am your host, Apostle Westbrook. And this is Shabach Saturday with Apostle Westbrook. Thank you, Holy Spirit, for reminding me that. Amen. But I'm excited, woman of God, of what you have in place in your belly. What you did share some of it with me. But I do know sometimes the Holy Ghost will do a complete flip on you, amen, and bring something else forth. But I am going to release the mic and allow you to pray, amen, and then release the word as the Spirit of the Lord will give you utterance in Jesus' name.
Hallelujah, hallelujah. Thank you, woman of God. I just want to say kingdom blessings to you and everyone that is joined on here today, just to give this opportunity to come on here and just share a word is to give God all the glory and honor. And I just lift up his holy name today. So, Father God, we just thank you, Lord God. We thank you, Father God, for this day. We thank you, Father God, for your word. We thank you, Father God, for those that are online today, Father God. May you give them ears to hear, Father God. Let it be your word go forth and be embedded in their hearts, Father God. I pray right now, Father God, as we go into this word today, Father God, that you would just let us be our prayer of our hearts today, Lord God, to do your will, Lord God, your will, not thy will, but your word, Father God. So we just thank you, Heavenly Father, and thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. In Jesus' name, amen. Woman of God, I just wanted to come on here today and, you know, as I was scrolling through social media the other day, I saw a post that was shared about a strange fire. And as I pondered on this, and it said that the actual post that said that a strange fire would not, cannot bring correction. And I was like, God, what is it about this strange fire? Because this word just kind of jumped off the page at me. And as he took me to the book of Leviticus. So, you know, I got into the word and I was like, you know, God, just give me a revelation of this, because in today's, it's as if the church has fallen away from the reverence of God's word, and that there is no reverence and there's no fear of God. But as I pondered on this, I just want to share what the Lord had me write and just take it from there. You know, fire is right. Apparently, not when it comes to the fire in the temple of God. The story of Aaron's sons, Nadab and Abihu, I believe I pronounced that right. In Leviticus 10, it might seem remote to us, but we have more in common with them than you might think. Like today's Christians, God knew them by name. God called them to his service and made them witnesses to the powerful work in their time. They were priests in the temple of God, just like we are in the temple that is our body. 1 Peter 2:9, and in 1 Corinthians 3, I believe it's 16:17. But they offered strange fire on the altar, and God struck them dead because of it. To us today, it's probably like just a tale to us. But let me share a little bit about this this scripture. Leviticus 10:1-3 says, "Then Nadab and Abihu, the sons of Aaron, each took his censer and put fire in it, put incense on it, and offered profane fire before the Lord, which he had not commanded them. So fire went out from the Lord and devoured them, and they died before the Lord. And Moses said to Aaron, 'This is what the Lord spoke, saying, by those who come near me, I must be regarded as holy. And before all the people, I must be glorious.' So Aaron held his peace." Father God, touch me in to give this word. Aaron and his sons had an important role. So God had given them very specific instructions when it came to ministering before the Lord. They were to take burning coals from the altar and ignite the incense before bringing it inside the veil. Leviticus 16:12. But Nadab and Abihu didn't listen to God's instruction. Instead of using the fire that God had kindled and preserved for himself, they had lit their own flame. They had offered strange fire. The strong cord that's given the definition of a strange is to turn aside, hence, to be foreign. It was like they committed a type of adultery. And when they did this, immediate judgment. God had sent his own fire to devour them. Their bodies were not consumed, though. Their cousins carried them out, and the people of Israel mourned for them. As for Aaron and his other two sons, Moses told them not to do so. They weren't to uncover their heads, tear their clothes, or even to leave the temple. The anointing of God was still upon them, and they needed to stay right where they were, ministering to the Lord. Moses gave God twofold reasons for the whole incident. God must be regarded as holy by those who came near, and before all the other people, he must be glorified. In Deuteronomy, God kind of gave us a metaphor. For the Lord your God is a consuming fire, and he's a jealous God. I guess I'd appreciate this a little better. It might help to understand how closely God relates himself with fire. For one thing, God appeared to Moses out of a burning bush, Exodus 3:2. Later, when the people of Israel left Egypt, God led them by a pillar of fire by night, and was the sole light of the wilderness for his people in Exodus 13:21. When the first tabernacle offering was made, God consumed it by fire, Leviticus 9:24. And likewise, when Solomon dedicated the first temple, God also sent fire from heaven. It hit the offering just before the presence of God filled that temple. 2 Chronicles 7:1. Finally, on the day of Pentecost, after a sound like a mighty wind, who had gathered in one accord, then they were filled with the Holy Spirit of God in Acts 2:3. God took fire very seriously because it was a representative of him. To treat it disrespectful was the equivalent of treating him with contempt. It wasn't something he could allow for those who came near him. He made sure that all the people knew that, and God's respect and glory were prominent. And it should be that way today as it was back then. There's just no fear of God in our churches today, and it grieves my heart so much. Woman of God, can you still hear me?
Yes, I can hear you very well.
Okay.
Amen.
Thank you, Father God. Sorry. There was an interruption coming through on my media, so I wanted to make sure. But to get back to this word, the Bible doesn't give a motive for Nadab and Abihu's behavior that day. But we might look at some possibilities and reasons as we do. Let us consider our own responsibility as those who, by the blood of Jesus, have access to the very presence of God. In Leviticus 6:13, a fire shall always be burning on the altar, and it shall never go out. So when I think about it, why didn't those brothers use the fire from God? You know, could it be because they had been distracted and allowed the fire of God to go out? Maybe they needed a substitute, had the thought that the fire, so it didn't matter where it came from? Think about our own walk with God. Have we maintained our relationship with Him? Do we live a life marked by Spirit-led Bible studies, continuous prayer, and hearing God's voice, and fervent worship? Are we just going through the emotions in mere compliance to religion and the systems? Or worse, have we replaced true worship with the truly profane? There are those who mix Christianity with these mystic practices or so-called Christian yoga and angel cards and all kinds of things that we hear out there. God's instruction is for us to worship in spirit and in truth. John 4:24, to do otherwise is to offer a strange fire. Anything that we do out of the will of God we're offering a strange fire to Him. You know, there's other possibilities for them that they didn't do what they were supposed to do. Possibly, you know, Leviticus 10:9 says, do not drink wine or intoxicating drink. You nor your sons with you when you go into the tabernacle of meeting, lest you die. It shall be a statue forever throughout your generations. You know, so why didn't the brothers keep that standard given by God? Could it be that they were incapacitated by wine? Some would say that Leviticus 10:9, the new rule that God instituted shortly after that incident, as evidence that this might have been the case. While drunkenness may not be the problem for all Christians, every one of us must guard against being impaired by the worldliness, anything that is worldliness and goes against God's commandments. Are we so confused with the things of the world that we offer only leftovers to God? Have we bowed to society's definitions of important concepts like love and tolerance and acceptance? Are we keeping firmly a biblical worldview? When we allow the world standards to color our priorities and values in relation to God, we are offering a strange fire. Many of the churches today have accepted tolerance to the things of this world. Acceptance, you know, Jesus, you know, he didn't preach acceptance, he preached repentance. And another possible reason could have been their pride. Exodus 24:9-10 says, and Moses went up also Aaron, Nadab, and Abihu, and 70 of the elders of Israel, and they saw the God of Israel, and there was under his feet as it were paved work of sapphire stone, and it was like the very heavens in its clarity. Why weren't the brothers afraid to do this thing before a holy God? Could it be they had witnessed? Could it be that they had gotten prideful? After all, the Jews were a chosen people. The brothers themselves were specifically called by God into service as his priests. Exodus 28:1. And they had stood in the very presence of God himself on the mountain. As Christians who have the Holy Spirit of God inside of us, each one of us hears his voice. We have been called into position, and maybe he has even used us mightily. Certainly, he has answered our prayers and shown himself strong on our behalf and has been with us and helped us when we needed him. We have been privileged to have witnessed his glory again and again. But our past experience with God can never be something to be prideful about. We can't get sloppy because God needs us. And we certainly can't start getting the idea that our way is an acceptable alternative to God's way. Worshiping from any other place than humility is offering strange fire before the Lord. So I pray right now that this story, you know, let Nadab and Abihu's sad story be a caution to us. To be a caution to us as Christians, as those that have been called by God. God deserves our respect, and we must worship him his way for his glory. We can't get so distracted by life that we fail to worship in spirit and in truth. We can't allow the world and its incapacitated way of, you know, to interfere with our thinking. We can't allow pride to replace humility in our worship. As Christians, we have been chosen and called by God into service. We have a responsibility to both God and to those who are watching our lives. God will be respected. He will be glorified. He may not go around striking people dead these days, but there will be consequences just the same. God is still very much a consuming fire. We will either allow him to burn away the impurities in our lives, or we will be the ones who are burned. Alone should be something that should go out and that people realize that, you know, we are going to be held responsible. There are consequences for our actions. You know, we either do the will of the Lord or you're doing the will of Satan, the enemy. What's the problem with the church today? You know, everybody wants to hear that make me good, feel good message. And, you know, sin is not preached in a lot of the churches today. The judgment of God is not mentioned in the churches today. Services that I go online and sometimes I'll click on them and, you know, it's all about prosperity and, you know, and you find that a lot of people are using scripture to justify their sin. You know, a failure to study and obey God's word has brought confusion into this world today. Men have left the guardianship of Christ for the guardianship of the great rebel, the prince of darkness. Strange fire has been mingled with the sacred what should be the sacred word of God. It's been mingled into the churches today. I heard a phrase that said the spirit of selfishness is a strange fire which should not be mingled with God's sacred service. We must keep the way of the Lord and speak and act as standing in his sight, living by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God, that no strange fire shall mingle with that which is holy. The Lord says, I am holy, therefore be. I am holy, he says. Shut it up. Light and darkness cannot mingle and be harmonized. Many act partly as children of time and partly as children of eternity. But if the Lord be God, follow him. But if Baal, then follow him. In 1 Kings 18:21, if you believe the word of God, submit your ways and guidance in all things unto the Lord. unto the Lord. Thank you, Father God. You know, as I was mentioning, you know, we must be in God's will at all times. It's His will, not our will. And as I was mentioning, you know, it says that we must worship Him in spirit and in truth. You know, it makes me think about that oneness that we have with the Lord. And when we are praying, as if we were praying in the Holy Spirit, you know, when we pray in the Holy Spirit, we have that union with the Father. And that's another thing that's not talked about in most of the churches today, is, and you don't hear much about it, is union with the Father. But we are one with Him. You know, 1 Corinthians 6 and 1 Corinthians 6, it says, He who is joined with the Lord is one spirit with Him. We are one spirit with Him. So I truly, you know, praying in the Spirit, you know, there are many scriptures in the Bible, you know, get into that place with Him where it, you know, when we pray, we're not praying from our own selfish state. We are praying the will of the Father. It has to be the will of the Father. And it comes from a surrendered posture. We need to be in that place with Him, you know, so that we don't become, you know, part of this, you know, churches that are rising up today that is practicing these strange fires, as we would call them. You know, the Bible says that, you know, we should have discernment, and then that in the last days that many false teachers and prophets will rise up. So we need to have that sovereign word of God embedded into our hearts. And that we need to be in that place of full surrender with Him, where we are one with Him. And that we would always be praying in the Spirit. To be able to withstand, you know, the things that are coming up and rising up in our communities, in our churches, in our schools, and, you know, our children. We just, you know, we need to be in that place of surrender and be praying in the will of the Father at all times, that we may walk in the will of the Father at all times. Right now, Father God, we just thank you, Father God. We thank you for your word, Father God. Our Father, you know, right now, we just come before you and we ask that by your Spirit, you will bring us to a place where we are truly able to pray from the heart, that your will be done. You know how strong our own wills are, Father. You know how hard we find it to submit to your way in our lives, Lord. Strengthen us to desire to do your will, Father. Strengthen us. We pray in regard to what you have kept secret, Father God. We look at our and our world, and we wonder, what are you doing, Father God? What are you doing? And the noise and the voices that advance, Father God, we just want to surrender at your cross, Father God. Just to surrender there, Father God. Help us to trust you when it is hard to understand what you are doing, Father God. Help us to know and believe that you reign in all things, Father God, including the things that we don't understand, Father God. We should lean not on our own understanding. So, Father, we pray that you will help us to grow in discernment, Father God. Lead us on the path of wisdom and guard us, Father God, from making any foolish decisions that are in our own will, Father God, and not your will, Father. Help us to think clearly and weigh, Father God, correctly. Father God, Give us the humility that seeks and hears the wise counsel of others. Help us to be vigorous in ruling out what you forbid, Father God, and ruling out what you command, Father God. Father, we thank you that you are our Savior. We thank you, Father God. I thank you, Lord God, that you are our Savior, that you know our struggles. You know our struggles when we have conflicts and how we struggle in our own desires, Lord. Give us the strength to believe your promises, to embrace your commands, and to bear the burdens you call us to carry, Father God. We just shut up our leadership. We pray that you will help us do your will fully, Father God. Love you with all our hearts and souls and minds and strength. Help us to love others. You said to love thy neighbor, Father God. Help us to make disciples of people from every background and to seek the good of people in every race, Father God. Save us from being unhappy Christians in the walk, Father God. Many get weary, Father God. To deliver us from the sinful habit of complaint, Father God. When we get tired and we complain, just, Father God, strengthen us. Help us to rejoice in you, to be in constant prayer, Father God, and to give thanks, Father, in the good and in the bad, Father God. Save us from thinking of prayer as a means by which we can get you to do our will, Father God. Make us more like Jesus. Teach us to say, your will be done through Jesus Christ. Teach us to that place to pray as Jesus did in the garden, that it be your will, not thy will, but your will, Father God. We need to come together, Father God. I pray for unity in the body of Christ, Father God, that we can come together, Father God, and that we will be able to pray for our communities, pray for our country, pray for our schools, Father God, our children, Lord God, and what they're being taught in their schools, Father God. I know that there is power in unity, Father God. But until the body of Christ is willing, Lord, I just pray that it would be their heart's desire, Lord. Father God, I think of your Spirit, Lord God, of the Holy Spirit as a rushing river, Lord God. And I want to jump in and just be immersed in that, Father God. So many Christians want to come to the bank of that mighty Russian river and just take sips of you, Lord, that they may still be in control, Father God. But let it be our heart's desire to jump fully into that river, Lord God, and be immersed in you, Father, that we may do your will, Lord God, Father God. Father God, we just come together today in prayer against those that are practicing, Lord God, this strange fire. We pray for the souls, Lord God, that are being affected, Lord God. Pray in unity together today. We just pray for the work that you are going to do in the body of Christ. We thank you for the things that are coming, Lord God, that you have showed us, Lord God. Pray to say that your will be done. As you taught us to pray, Father God, our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us, Lord, today our daily bread and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from all evil. For thine is the kingdom and the glory forever. I just pray blessings over everyone on this broadcast today, Father God. I just pray blessings upon their families, Lord God. I pray for Chin, Lord God. I pray, Father God, that you would lead, God, and direct them in all this, your ways, Father God. And we just give you glory and we give you honor, Father God, for you are worthy of our praise, Lord God. You are worthy of our praise, Lord. And we just thank you. In Jesus' mighty name, amen and amen. And we just thank you, Lord God. Hallelujah, hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father God. Hallelujah. I want to thank you for tuning in on this very special Shabach Saturday with our featured guest, amen, Evangelist Melissa Ross. Powerful word regarding the fire. My God, the fire of God. Ooh, strange fire. Woman of God, when you mentioned that, I thought about how the Bible referenced two types of fire in Scripture, amen, the consuming fire, which you reference, amen, and also the fire that was witnessed in the book of Acts when they received the Holy Ghost and began to speak with other tongues in Jesus' name. But indeed, as you noted, these two individuals, and even today in some of our churches, not all of our churches.
No, not
but
all.
In some, amen. No. But in some of our churches and some that have a significant attendance, they are offering a strange fire that indeed is grieving the Spirit of God. He is a jealous God. He is the consuming fire, not a consuming fire, but the consuming fire in Jesus' name. And we cannot and do not have the opportunity to allow ourselves to become entangled with such practices out of pride or ego or self-aggrandizement. But there needs to be a fear of God, truly a reverential fear of God is indeed absent in some of our churches. And I believe that that is part, a significant part of the problem, why the world looks at us in wonderment, my God, today and almost mocking us because we're not walking the talk. And I'm not saying all of us, but those that do such practices, the Spirit of the Lord will not honor that in the name of Jesus.
No.
As you said, you know, we must worship him in spirit and in truth in Jesus' name, because that which is sacred and holy cannot be mingled with the things of the world and tagged Christian. And we put this label on it and say that that's Christian, that's the Christian way, but it is not the way or the truth according to the Word of God. I want to thank you again for coming forth and bringing this word. It is such a sober word. It makes me do a self-examination, and I pray that those that are listening, and even those that will be listening on the rebroadcast when it's posted on YouTube, that you will do a self-examination. Are you as fervent as you should be in your study of the word? Are you as fervent and passionate in your prayer time or your worship or your fellowship in intimacy with the Father? My God, today, you asked a very poignant question too. You said, you know, it's interesting. Why did these two brothers not keep the standard? It's not like they didn't know what to do. They had obviously done it many times before. But why did they one day make a decision that they were going to do it their way? And it makes me think about those who know the faith who know the kingdom principles, one day they make a decision that they're going to do it their way.
Yes, many, I feel that many do that.
Go ahead. Yes.
You know, when I think about that question, that, you know, the why did they do that when they knew they were handpicked, they were, you know, in the glory of God, but they still did, they still directly disobeyed.
Amen.
The will of the Father. The will of the Father. So it just you know, when it reached out, I was like, you know, and I continue to read, and you know, and I was looking at scenarios that it could be possibly comparing those scenarios with how we walk with God today, and it was deliberate, and we. And unfortunately, and I do want to say that, you know, as you were saying, I wasn't pointing out that it's all Christians or all churches, but a majority of them do have very large platforms that you know, we see, and the amount of followings that you see that they have, and they're leading so many people astray, and that they say that to where all these precious souls, you know, the Lord doesn't want one soul to be loose, but all these precious souls are thinking that it's okay, that, you know, that the things that they are doing, you know, that it's okay, you know, God will, you know, will honor it,
it's,
you know, and they use scripture to justify their sin, and it's sad, because in this day and time, it's like, you know, the Lord is coming, and he's coming back soon. And we need to get right with God. And there's no, and it's just, you know, it's something that I've just been really, the Lord has really laid on my heart, and about the fact that there is just no, he says, you know, there's no, they do not fear me. There's no fear of God. And it's not like we're supposed to be, you know, like frightened fear of God. But there should be that fervent fear of the Lord. And because, you know, he is a God of judgment. But people don't minister that in the church. They don't minister that sin is not okay, that it's not okay for us to continue to walk in sin. You know, once we give our hearts and our life to the Lord, you know, we are to turn from our sin and go and sin no more, he says. But, you know, many people think that they use God's grace as a get out of jail free card, to where it's okay, you know, as long as you repent, you've been forgiven. But the word God, as we were talking ourselves, woman of God, that, you know, the word says in Hebrews that eventually, if you continue to commit willful sin, that there will be no more sacrifice for your sin. And that it goes down a little further to say that it's a fearful thing to fall into the hands of a living God.
Amen.
And that scripture alone should, you know, give some people fear. You know, once we get saved, you know, we've been saved by grace, but we've also been giving that the Spirit of the Lord to be able to, we've been brought into righteousness. That and the Spirit of the Lord will help us turn away. There's got to be transformation, I would say. You would see it in a true repentant heart. You will see that transformation begin to take place. You know, we're not, you know, he knew we couldn't do it on our own. That's why he sent Jesus. That's why he sent his son. But he says, be holy for I am holy.
Amen. Amen.
And we need to try to do better. And, you know, and a lot of people don't spend time in prayer. You know, I asked you know, people sometimes, you know, how much time do you spend a week in prayer? You know, he says to pray all the time. I pray going up and down the road. I pray, you know, everywhere. I was praying in the Dollar General store walking through, and the Spirit hit me, and I just began to pray. You know, I pray, you know, we are to pray. And, you know, I'm always talking to God, you know, and, you know, I talk to him just like talking to a friend. And a lot of people say, well, I don't know how to pray. I'm like, well, you know how to, you're sitting here carrying a conversation. It's the same as carrying a conversation with your father. But then sometimes, you know, people do get to a point where, you know, where only time they're lifting up prayers is when they need something or they want something. Or, you know, we also need to get in that place of intimacy with him and say, okay, Father, here I am. Here I am. Speak to me. You tell me what your will is. What do you want, Father God? He says, you know, and then many times, you know, and the scripture says, you know, come, let us reason together. But a lot of people don't get into that intimacy with the Father and just spend that time with them. They, you know, they'll sit there for hours and hours and scroll through their Facebook and social media and Instagram and all those things, you know, which I've always believed that the, you know, social media was, you know, the devil's playground. But, you know, but they spend 10 minutes in prayer.
Lord, help.
And, you know, and I just pray, Father God, that, you know, I pray all the time for the people of God to grasp the importance of getting into prayer and spending time prayer. That is the one thing that the enemy likes to interfere with. He wants people to think that, you know, prayer is you know, it's just, you know, too much. and he fills people's schedules up, but we need to take that time out. And have that daily prayer with the Father. You know, I pray before I even get out of the bed in the morning to start my day. You know, I send gives like the God. I give this day to you already. You know, so you know, and it is that because I do ask sometimes. How often do you pray? And many a times, you know, well, I'll pray before I go to bed at night, or I pray when, you know, things go wrong. And I was like, but your heart desire should be able to pray and go into that place of intimacy with the Father. And it breaks my heart because you don't see that. You don't even see it in the churches today. You know, I brought it up with my pastor on Sunday, you know, when I was ministering. I said, you know, we used to do all-night prayer night one Friday night. I said, and the Lord is calling us to come back to the altar, to come back to that intimacy with them and pray and seek his face and seek him for everything. Seek him, you know, before in anything we do in our life, it should start with prayer. And from that place of surrender with the Father.
That allows the Holy Spirit to be that filter of our day when we set him to be the chief. He takes the helm as we enter in prayer and we surrender ourselves and the day as it comes upon us and surrender ourselves to the will of the Father as we move in him. Hallelujah. And the Holy Spirit is that filter that we need in this hour to walk out this life that we are now contending with, each and every believer. But I love that the Holy Spirit that we have, oh God, who is exemplary of the fire of God that rests within us, enables us, empowers us, gives us the power and the enabling power to walk out this life in the perfect will of God, according to Romans 8, in Jesus' name. It mentions us when we allow ourselves to pray in the Holy Spirit. He who knows the mind of God prays the perfect will of God for us.
Yes.
Woman of God, you said so much today, and I know that when we hear the good news Amen. We have an option to choose, to make a choice, just like the two sons, amen, had an option. They had a choice to make. They could have continued to press on with the standard that they knew, but they made a choice to do it their way. And I can only think that, you know what, you mentioned that the way of the Lord, the way of faith, as I call it, which is the way of life. It's a narrow way, woman of God, but it leads to life. But the word says many are few that will find it. You have to want to seek it. We seek it through that intimacy, through that prayer and intercession, the relationship, the fellowship that we have with the Father. And it is a way of holiness, as the scripture says, because anything unclean, anything that is tainted, anything that is strange cannot travel that way. But we who have made a decision to walk out this life, to be consecrated before Him, to walk in the way, amen. The scripture says that the fools will not stray onto it. They will not find it because they're not seeking it. It's a very narrow gate, woman of God. But unfortunately, broad is the way that leads to destruction. And I think about these mega churches that are leading many to destruction because of erroneous doctrine, because of strange fire, because of their platforms and their dogma. But the scripture warns us to beware of such. They are false prophets, as they call them. They come in sheep's clothing, but inwardly they're ravenous wolves. Truly, yes. The hour that we are living in, so many people are being traumatized. So many people are hurting. So many people are looking for a place to belong. They're looking for a place where they can fit in. They really have a heart to want to seek God and to know Him earnestly. But unfortunately, some are being led astray. But thank God we as believers, amen. The word says we have been accepted in the beloved. We are beloved, His beloved, as we offer ourselves on the altar. Ooh, to be consumed by the fire of God so that He can make us pure, so that we can come forth as vessels of honor, as we are reconciled back to Him. Glory to God. And walk in the way and the truth in the name of Jesus. Because He is a holy God. And He will accept us as He is, so are we. Amen. And the interesting about this is that we don't need to have a life that is cleaned up, but, you know, prior to us coming to Him, but, and I say that emphatically, but when we accept Him, as you said, there should be a transformation because we are giving Him permission, amen, to come and change us.
Yes. You know, God knows our heart, woman of God. He knows what we truly believe in our attitude towards Him. He knows all. And, you know, we cannot offer Him like proud sacrifices. You know, so many people are caught up in that spirit of pride that, you know, those types of sacrifices to God are unworthy to Him. You know, He seeks those who want to come to Him in humility, ready to sacrifice, you know, their pride and lay before Him in a humble and contrite heart, you know, grieving for sin.
Amen.
I think it's Psalms 51:17.
We're supposed to deny ourselves.
God, our broken spirit, mm-hmm, and a broken and contrite heart.
Amen. And he will not deny. Glory to God. He will not deny us. Ooh, glory to God. As we deny ourselves. But that's what we're supposed to do. Deny ourselves, take up his cross, and follow him. And it is as simple as that.
You know, there is a grace and forgiveness, and there's plenty of second chances, you know, for those that belong to him. You know, but God wants us to know that he's serious when it comes to his honor and his glory. You know, if there's willful disobedience in the life, in our lives, or the life of a believer, then God disciplines us out of his great love for us. And, you know, that's part of in Hebrews where it talks about, you know, where I mentioned, you know, I think it's in Hebrews 12:12. It talks about the discipline, Hebrews 12. It is for discipline that you have to endure. And God is treating you as sons. For what sons is there whom his father does not discipline? And if you are left without discipline in which all participated, then you are illegitimate children and not sons. God will take harsher measures until we understand how we are disappointing him. You know, I think about, you know, there's another story that is similar to that in the Bible. You know, God, you know, he will remove things or take us from this earth for disobedience and dishonor and grace to him. You know, we think about there was the story where where the husband and wife, they lied to Peter about some land given to the church, and they judged and physically and they had a physical death because of their lie.
Ananias and Sapphira, I think it is.
We just thank you, Father. We just want, Father God, your will. Father God, help us to walk in obedience to you, Father God. Strengthen us, Lord God. We can't do things on our own, Father God, but we can do all things through you who strengthen us, Lord God. Help us to look to you, Father. Help us to look to you.
People just don't understand the gravity of this hour that we're living in, and they're sort of like being very nonchalant about their posture, their faith, and as if they're wearing it like some sort of Monica, I don't know what it's called, label, that's it, that's the word I want to use, like it's some sort of label, you know, they put different designer labels on jeans, so if you're of the household of faith, you know, you have your t-shirts, all that stuff, amen, all of the pageantry, yes, but it's all fluff and no power. It grieves the Holy Spirit, it truly grieves the Spirit of God. But this is the hour where, you know, it is time we need to make a decision. He said, I would rather you be hot or cold. Make up your mind. Are you going to live this for real? Right. Or is it just a part-time kind of thing? You know, it's like you're pimping God. When you need him, I know my daddy.
Yeah.
But when you don't need him, you don't know him. It's like, where are you? Where are you? But listen, people of God, do not doubt what the Spirit of the Lord is saying to us and what has been released in your hearing. Woman of God, did you want to say something?
So you were just saying how that the word says, you know, you are neither hot nor cold, you know, that goes along with that scripture. Again, you know, there's consequences there, you know, because he says that, you know, he will spew you out of his mouth.
Amen.
You know, so we, you know, there's consequences for our disobedience. And, and not wanting to stay in the will of the Father. And especially those that have been called. You know, this message that I brought today, you know, it's more for the believer, not the unbeliever, because they don't know, you know, these things. They haven't been taught these things yet.
Yes, and we have greater accountability because we do know.
Right.
So there be greater consequences in the name of Jesus.
The judgment shall start in the house of the Lord.
Amen. But the good news is,
yes, hallelujah,
those who are known by him and know his name, glory to God, and who have truly made a decision to honor
Amen.
Him and understand the importance of when he says, be holy to me, for I am the Lord, I am holy, I have set you apart. They identify with that. They live that. They manifest that in their everyday
yes.
living. They're not making choices that would bring mockery to the Father. I'm going to use myself as an example, and then I'm going to ask you, woman of God, if you would release a prayer of salvation for those who maybe do not know. But I was... And this was a rebuke that I had received by a man of God, a acquaintance, amen, a friend, who I honor and praise the Lord and I love dearly. And the point of it was, you know what? If you say something, you have to walk in integrity. You have to be integral about what you do. You have to walk in honor of that. But if you find yourself in situations where your flesh is pulling you, that means that that has not been subdued yet, that you have not submitted that part of you to the Spirit of God. There's still life in that you need to kill. And some people think that's very harsh, you know, or they may even label you that you're being super religious. Have you heard that? But it comes down to this one thing. I mean, if God himself said, you are to be holy to me. He said, you are to be holy to me, for I, the Lord, am holy. And I have set you apart from the people to be mine. He has purposely, intentionally set you apart. He has purposely, intentionally chosen you to be his representation here in this earth realm to a world, as I said before, that is traumatized, that is hurting, that needs to see an authentic move of God. And some of us are AWOL, we're AWOL. We're in, we're out. We're in, we're out. You know, it's like doing a dance. You see, one day you see them, and super Christian, amen. And that's not to say that we have some days that are challenging, but that doesn't make you lose your faith. That doesn't make you operate in a nature that would bring, that would grieve your Father. It's like a child and your dad. Their parents, you wouldn't do anything to dishonor them because you represent them when you step outside of the house. I know parents are those that do believe in discipline. They'll always tell you, don't you misrepresent me. You represent us when you step out of this house. So act accordingly. And who
right.
would
and
not
I'm
want
so
to...
thankful for those that the Lord has put in my path, you know, that teaches us, you know, even us that, you know, we all are teachable. You know, I don't know about you or anyone else on this broadcast today, you know, but when I open the Word of God, you know, it's a living Word. It speaks to me. I learn something new every time I open the Bible. I've read it from front to back many times, but I still learn something new that He gives me revelation about, you know, and, you know, I have, you know, a spiritual dad, And, you know, and if I do something that is out of the will of God, he will bring correction to me. Or if I make a mistake or I'm ministering and, you know, he will bring that correction to me and teach me, you know, that, you know, the right way, you know. And we all are teachable, and we all need to have that teachable heart, that teachable spirit about us, you know. Of
Amen.
Course, the Holy Spirit is the greatest teacher that we have. But, you know, we all need to be in the will of fire. You know, when I just, you know, we all need to have that word embedded in our hearts. And that is my cry for the people. If we don't get into the word of God, you know, and let it be embedded in our hearts, how can we have that discernment when we are walk into a church or we are go to click on a sermon and we're listening to it to know that that is not from God? It does not align with the true word of God. We need to
Amen.
Know the word of God that we can discern that that is not in alignment with the word of God. You know, many false teachers and prophets are lining up, you know, have come out in the world today. You know, the Bible warned us of that. You know, when it comes to prophecy, I'm very cautious to it because, you know, when someone begins to prophesy, if it's not in the line of with the word, then I'm not going to receive it. We have to be careful. We have to get into the word. We have to know the word to be able to discern that what is of God and what is not of God.
Amen.
Because many false teachers have already come out into the world today. You know, we see the Bible unfolding before us so much today.
Every day. Every day.
You know, I have been in services that I have gotten up and walked out of because it's a strange fire, as we minister today. You know, there are many spirits that are operating in the church today that is not of the Holy Spirit. It is that of another spirit. You know, and that's a whole teaching for another time. But yeah,
Amen. You know,
we have to have the word embedded and know that word. You know, if we sit there and we receive that is not of God, then, you know, we are as guilty as they are.
Hallelujah.
Praise you, Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Let us, Lord God, help us to know your will for us.
Can you go ahead and release a prayer of salvation, amen, for those that perhaps do not know him yet?
Most Heavenly Father, we just, our prayer today, Father God, is to, you know, is for the lost, Lord God, for those, Father God, that do not know you, that doesn't know your grace, your mercy, Father God, that is offered to them, the gift of salvation is free, Father God, that we pray, Father God, that you would put people, true people of God, that would minister to them, Lord God, and lead them to you, Father God, to the cross, that their souls may be saved, Father God. It is not about us, Father God, but it's about souls, Lord God, for your kingdom, Lord God. So I pray, Father God, even those that are still new to their walk with you, Lord God, that you will put men and women of God of faith, Lord God, that know your word, to help raise them up, Lord God, to teach them, Father God. For there are many that are still on the milk, Father God, but there, Father God, that we just lead them, Lord God, and direct them, Father God. And I do pray, Father God, for the word today that went forth, Lord, that you would let it be embedded in our hearts, Lord God, as we search ourselves, Lord God, as we search ourselves, Father God. I pray, Father God, that you would just lead us in all your ways, Lord God, that it would be your will for us, Father God, not our will, but your will. And we just thank you, Heavenly Father, and we lift up your holy name. Amen and amen.
where the sun is always shining, folks are always smiling, go play. Where crying is unheard of, and dying ain't even thought.
I want to say thank you again, each and every one for that have joined us and are here with us. Evangelist Melissa, is there any way that people can connect with you? Can you give them your contact information, particularly if they want to come and be with you on Fridays for the intercessory prayer? Praise the Lord. I think we may have lost her, but she is on Facebook. Amen. And her name is Melissa Ross, in the name of Jesus. Melissa Ross, and you can contact her or DM her to get more information regarding the Friday night's intercessory prayer at Harvest Amen Nights Outreach Center in Front Royal, in Jesus' name. I want to say, Father God, thank you again for your presence and for this great move of God in our listening. I pray that you all have been blessed. Please continue to pray with us and for us as we are growing, amen, and making adjustments with some technical challenges. But nonetheless, we know that the Spirit of God has indeed spoken to us this day regarding this strange fire that we're seeing in some of our mega churches. But those who are known by his name and who know him, hallelujah, we shall do great exploits, and we will demonstrate the glory and the power of God. I want to say thank you again for stopping by, amen, for another Shabach Saturday. Thank you, Dr. Kimmy Kim and the Elation Radio family, for this platform. I thank God's people that are with us and those will be listening on the rebroadcast. And I pray the Lord will continue to bless you and continue to enlarge your borders and territories in Jesus' name. Again, thank you for joining us this Shabach Saturday. Evangelist Melissa Ross, may the Lord bless you richly for your outpouring and for your unselfish service in Jesus' name. Everyone, please come back next Saturday at 3 p.m. Eastern Standard Time for another Shabach Saturday at this great station, Elation Radio. And again, thank you, Dr. Kimmy Kim, our producer, for your example and your heart. May the Lord God continue to use you, great woman of God. Now please close us out. Double shalom. I love you. God bless you.
There's a place that I wanna go, where the sun is always shining, folks are always smiling, go a play. Where crying is unheard of, and dying ain't even thought of, oh, a place where there's no color of skin. You won't find no sin, oh, a place. And I wanna get there. Yeah, I'm gonna get there one day. I wanna get there. I'm gonna get there one day. Caught up in the air to meet him. get there, and you should wanna get there one day.